I learned this early in medicine, okay? And I'm a slow learner, okay? I'm a slow learner. As a physician assistant, or if you're in medicine in general, but really, if you're a physician assistant nurse practitioner, you're an advanced practitioner, you're the ultimate middleman, okay? You're the ultimate middleman in coordinating care. And when I say that, I mean, you're on the front lines. You're in the trenches looking into the eyes of the patients, okay, at a very deep level. So we're seeing the sick child. We're taking care of the guy with the heart attack or stroke. We're breaking the news about cancer, okay? We're putting stitches in. I mean, we're doing really cool things face-to-face with the patients, okay? But also, we get to coordinate care with our supervising or collaborating docs, okay? We have the privilege of working with physicians that have tremendous training, tremendous knowledge and responsibility. We have to coordinate the care, so we have to bring the cares and concerns of the patient at times to our supervising or collaborating doc and coordinate care. And how we affect this team is critically important, but it doesn't stop there. We have to coordinate care with lots of ancillary staff, the nursing staff who are tremendously overworked, okay? Respiratory therapists, we got lab techs and x-ray techs, security, administrative personnel, housekeeping. We have to coordinate care to best serve our patients, and that takes a high degree of influence. Now, as a medical practitioner, you really need two skills. One is medical knowledge, okay? You have to have a high degree of knowledge. Got to. But the second thing, I could argue more importantly as a mid-level provider or advanced practitioner, if you will, is influence. You have to positively be able to influence people to contribute to the greater good, to best serve the patients that you care for. So you have to really be in tune, engaged with the whole circle of medical care, because we coordinate a lot of care, and influence is the key skill. And that's what we're going to talk about today. Caveman influence. Caveman influence and the practice of modern medicine. How do we take the skills that the cavemen learned to survive, and how do we use that to help us practice medicine? Now, influence cannot be talked about unless you talk about the bad side, the negative side of influence, okay? What's the difference between influencing someone and manipulation? This is important. It's important because what I'm going to share with you are powerful tools. Who knows these tools really well? Advertisers do. Anybody who gets us to say yes to anything, it's because they influenced us. And there are techniques that are studied, and they're visceral in nature. When I say that, I mean our core has been designed to respond to certain things. And I believe it had to do with genetics, about how the caveman survived. There were certain skill sets that triggered the cavemen, which, I mean, I'm going to use this as a scientific talk, but I believe it's spiritual in nature too, where we had gifts. Ways that we respond to others in a way that's visceral and almost subconscious. You see, this has been very well studied, okay? Like, why don't they let pharmaceutical companies give out pens anymore? Well, because it works. It works. It makes us want to use their medicine, and we're biased to it, even though you don't think so. That's the brilliance of it. Is that we do things that we didn't even know we're doing just because we're positively influenced by that. So when it comes to influence and versus manipulation, a tremendous amount of weight goes to our motivations. How much do we truly want to serve our patients to best get them to an optimal state of health, okay? If you use tools to better get your diabetic to control their sugars, you've done a tremendous service. If you use tools to get your patients to cut down on smoking, tremendously powerful stuff to help your patients. Now, there is a negative side of influence. There's a negative side of influence. People like Bernie Madoff, okay? Lance Armstrong, people who used influence for negative reasons. And there are three major characteristics of people who will use influence in a negative way. The first one is someone who is psychopathy, or someone with an antisocial personality disorder, which basically means they don't care about the feelings of others. It just doesn't faze them. Second phase, or the second part of this, what they call the dark triad, is Machiavellianism. These are people who will manipulate. They'll manipulate, they'll scheme, they'll fib, okay? The last one is someone who's narcissistic, who really thinks it's all about them. And if you are going to apply these techniques of influence, know that they're used to best serve our patients. That's how I use them clinically, and it's made my job incredibly more effective taking care of patients in the emergency room. So influence is designed to positively help patients meet their own needs. Now, anytime you try to influence someone, you get one of three responses. Okay, you either get conflict. Okay, so the gentleman who comes in with chronic back pain who wants their Lortab prescription, if I say no, okay, well, that's more times than not going to create some degree of conflict. Okay, second phase is compliance. These are people who do it. I ain't real happy about it, though. I identify with that often when I ask my kids to clean the room. When I say ask, in a dadly kind of way. You can use soft techniques or hard techniques. Clean your room, please. Go clean your room. Okay, get compliance. Our ultimate goal is commitment. That's what we shoot for. That's what we strive for when taking care of our patients. How do we get commitment from your patients that they not only agree that their kid doesn't need a CAT scan for a minor head injury, but they're good with it. Now all of a sudden they wouldn't want the CAT scan. So these are the tools of influence. How do we use them in an honorable and ethical way to best serve our patients? Now I need to tell you a story to help this come to life. Now once upon a time there were many different classes of cavemen. And let's picture it this way. Let's pretend we're on the Starship Enterprise and we go to a planet and we get to study these cavemen, these primitive living humans. We're not allowed to affect them, though. We can just study them. So we start studying them, and we realize there's a lot of different classes of cavemen. But as we study the history, you know, all these different classes, a lot of them didn't make it. They died out for whatever reason. So there's many classes of cavemen. A lot of them died out, like the A class of cavemen. If they're an A class, they're really selfish. They only think of themselves. Therefore, they don't do well. They'll die off. Or the B class, they're always changing their mind. They can't stay structured. The C class, they didn't get along with each other, so they didn't support each other. They're going to die off. So if we say, oh, that's a D class of cavemen, they're not going to do well. The D class, there's no leaders, okay? No one with real credibility to lead, so they don't follow each other. E class, they didn't trust each other, okay? The F class, no system of economics within their tribe, and et cetera, okay? There's all sorts of different classes of cavemen that didn't work, and there's many combinations of classes, but there's one class of cavemen. If we can classify them as an R class, if the R class of cavemen had certain characteristics that made them prone to live. Now listen to what I'm saying, folks. The R class of cavemen, there's six components of influence that we can use to positively affect our patients, to deeply affect our patients, to get them more prone to say yes. And there's a lot of literature behind this, a lot of studies that basically say, if you apply these techniques, if you become a student of influence, you double your chances of being effective with them. You double the chances of them not wanting to take an antibiotic for a viral URI. Or you double the chances of getting them to wear a condom when having sex and getting them to practice safe sex. You double the chances of getting them to quit smoking. It's powerful stuff, okay? Not only will it help you positively affect your patients, but now you'll understand when advertisers are doing it to you so you can make more conscious and knowledgeable choices. So the R class of cavemen, these are people that would share. These are people that could be, meaning they found an identity and would stick to the identity. Very powerful to cavemen. These are people that could make friends with one another. These are people that would specialize in certain areas. These are people that knew economics. They knew scarcity. They knew how important that was, and they learned how to learn from each other. So this is the R class of cavemen. There's six components of influence that the caveman had. Now, R is reciprocity. It's the law of reciprocity. We're going to talk about each one of these. C is consistency. L is likability. A is authority. S is scarcity. And S is social proof. Now, I'm going to need you to actively be engaged in this R class. So I want you to start trying to plug these in so you can see how you can best use these skills clinically to positively influence your patients. So reciprocity, consistency, likability, authority, scarcity, social proof. Let's look into reciprocity, the law of reciprocity. I'll scratch your back if you scratch my back. Now just think about this. How would the cavemen have to use this? How would they have to use this to survive, okay? I mean, the law of reciprocity means this. We try to repay in kind what another person has provided to us. Now, the result was a lower of the natural inhibitions against transactions, which means if you go out and killed food and you brought back all this food, some cavemen wouldn't share their food, and that would cause other cavemen to die out. But if you shared your food, the chances are people were going to give you something in return. And that's what the cavemen did. That's a trait that survivalistic cavemen had. I mean, I believe it's a God-given gift, the law of reciprocity, and it's very well talked about in the Bible, Matthew 7:2. Do unto others what you'd have them do unto you. It's a God-given gift, but it's also a survival mechanism, meaning that when you give away without the goal of getting in return, good things happen to you. It's a natural tendency. We can't help it, okay? Like in the movie Up. In the movie Up by Walt, you know, Pixar, Disney. I love the movie. But at one point, these people met these dogs with collars on, and these collars allowed the dogs to vocalize their words. So the dogs just breathing, but you could hear them saying, oh, this, my, I have a good master, and he's a very good master, and he's a strong master, and I love him very much. Squirrel! Because a squirrel ran by and something triggered inside of them to look at the squirrel. That's what reciprocity does. When people are giving away things to others without the goal of getting anything in return, we have a tendency to want to repay in kind what another has done for us. Okay? This has been well studied by advertisers like the Disabled American Veterans. They would do this, okay? They would send out mailers saying, hey, send us some money, give us contributions. And they realized they were only getting about a 17-18% return on these mailouts, okay? But what they did was, they started sending out free mailing labels with your name on that, and asking for donations. With the mailing label attached, donations doubled. It went up to 35%. What happens is when someone gives you something, we want to relieve ourselves of the psychological burden of debt by giving something in return. The Hare Krishnas did this wonderfully in the airports, very well studied. People would be walking through the airports, minding their own business, and all of a sudden someone in a robe and a shaved head would say, oh, here's a flower. And you take the flower, here's a flower, it's a gift from the Hare Krishnas. Can we have a donation? You're like, we don't want to be known as a mooch, a welch, someone, an ingrate. We don't want that. That tremendously is unattractive to us. So we have a tendency to want to return in kind what others have done for us. What about favors? What about favors? When someone does a favor, especially professionally, do favors age like bread or wine? Okay? Do favors age like bread, which means the older it gets, the more stale it gets? Or does it age like wine, meaning it becomes more valuable? Here's an important point about reciprocity and the need to want to repay others. Now, if you do a favor, let's say you're covering a shift for somebody else, or maybe taking call for somebody else. When you are providing the favor, psychologically it's perceived as a little thing. Yeah, I'll cover your shift, no problem. Now, the person that you're covering for so they can go to a wedding or their kid's baseball game, it's a really big thing to them. So what happens often is, hey, John, can you cover the shift for me? Yeah, sure, I'm glad to. No problem. To me, it's a little thing. To them, it's like, oh, man, now I get to go to this party, this picnic. Woohoo! So to me, it's a little thing. To them, it's a big thing. But as time goes by, I don't quite forget it. The psychological tendency is if I did someone a favor, I kind of remember it even though it's small. The person who I did a favor for, they have a tendency to forget the favor. Okay, it's just human nature. And what happens often is this. Oh, thank you so much for doing that. Oh, no problem. When I say no problem, psychologically, I remove the burden from them. Oh, it's no problem. I guess they just do it because they're a nice guy. I don't need to repay them. Now, the law of reciprocity says our natural tendency is to repay in kind, but people forget. So what you can do is turn people into elephants. And when I say that, I mean the receiver of a favor. You can turn them into an elephant. And remember, an elephant never forgets. So if someone calls and says, hey, John, can you cover the shift for me? Sure, I can do that. Oh, thank you so much. I have one of two choices now. I can say, hey, no problem, I'm glad to do it. Or I can respond and give them a way to embrace the law of reciprocity by saying, hey, I know you'd do the same for me if I needed something. Okay? What you do is you allow them an out for the law of reciprocity. So as time goes by, they're less likely to forget. So once again, if you do a favor for someone else and they're very thankful, great, but give them permission to return the favor by saying, I know you'd do the same for me if I needed something. So I'm glad to do it for you. Another component of the law of reciprocity is that of reverse concessions. And I see this often done in medicine. I've seen it often, and I've used it often when calling consultants. Reverse concessions means this. Based on the first stimuli, if it's incredibly unattractive, and you have to say no, you'll say yes to a smaller component. So picture this. If I went to a caveman and said, hey, that T-Rex out there, yeah, can you go kill him for me? The caveman's going to go, no. No, I'm not going to kill him. All right, well, can you at least go kill the rattlesnake? Then all of a sudden they're going to go, yeah, I'll kill the rattlesnake. I'd kill the T-Rex. I'll kill the rattlesnake, though. Reverse concessions is a powerful way to get people to say yes by contrasting it with a big request to a small request. Picture saying to a patient who's a diabetic, they're overweight, they have high cholesterol. If you say, hey, listen, this is what I'd like you to do, and I'd like you to agree with me here. Will you agree to get a personal trainer, and I'd like you to do it tomorrow? I'd like you to go to the gym at least 3 times a week for strength training. So I want you to do 1 hour strength training 3 times a week and attend 2 spin classes a week. So I need you to get a personal trainer, go to the gym 5 times a week, 3 times a week do weights, and 2 times a week I would like you to do a spin class. Can you do that for me? Is that okay? And they're going to say, no, not doing that. If they're honest, okay, if you nurture that relationship, then if you present them, well, will you at least agree to walk 10 minutes a day 3 times a week? The law of reciprocity and reverse concessions puts people in a position to say much easier, yeah, I'll do that smaller request, but I'm not going to do that bigger request, okay? Now, when it comes to consultants, if you are calling a consultant, reverse concessions can be very useful as a tool to get them to say yes when they answer the phone. And I remember being a young provider and seeing some of these senior veteran providers use this tool, which I actually thought was wimpy. Okay, they would call a cardiologist who's on call. Cardiologist get on the phone, hey, this is Dr. So-and-so. And the provider would say, hey, oh, I'm really sorry to bother you. And allow the doc to respond back. And my first response was, well, they're on call. They're not supposed to be bothered. Yeah, but that's me being foolish. That's not using tools of influence. What you're saying is, with this statement, I'm sorry that I'm a PA and I'm bothering you because I know you're a doctor. That's really what's being conveyed. Oh man, I'm sorry that I'm bothering you because you're a doctor and I'm a mid-level provider and I'm sorry about that. They feel that and their response to that is, oh, no bother, I'm glad to help you. Huh. Well, if you're glad to help me because of the social norm hierarchy of being a PA or nurse practitioner versus a doc, can you at least help me with a patient? And you get a higher degree of acceptance and influence and commitment to best take care of the patient. You know what it's like to call a consultant and get one of three answers. You get conflict, compliance, or commitment. The best thing for your patients is to get commitment. So reverse concessions is another way of saying, hey, can you kill a T-Rex? No, I ain't killing a T-Rex. Well, can you at least kill the snake? Oh, yeah, I'll kill the snake for you. So reverse concessions is a tool to help consultants best want to help your patient. R is reciprocity. C is consistency. Consistency, powerful. Powerful. To stay aligned to a previous self-perception. We have, and the cavemen had, a survival tool is that of consistency. We have this tremendous drive to stay consistent to what we've established ourselves as. And if you've ever broken that, you get a pit in your stomach. Like, have you ever made a New Year's resolution and you really felt determined that this is what you were going to do, and then when you didn't do it, you felt like crap, okay? That comes in different stages. Our mind wants to stay consistent to what we see ourselves as being, and this is powerful. This is powerful to really transform and change yourself, change how you look at yourself. Now, Ralph Waldo Emerson, he said that a foolish consistency is the hobgoblin of little mind. A fool's consistency is the hobgoblin of little mind. What is he saying here? What is he saying about hobgoblins? He's saying that we make a consistency up. We make our mind up about something. We have a genetic predisposition to stay firm to that. Well, Ralph Waldo Emerson saying a foolish consistency is bad. It's negative. It's tremendously bad. We make up something. Drop the hammer and say, okay, that's how it is. We have a tough time stepping away from it and repositioning our brains. So we strive to stay consistent, and so do your patients. A way to best change this is what's called labeling. Labeling your patient. And boy, I've seen it used on me many times. It's interesting, and in no way do I think this lecture is going to be a catch-all. Like, it's going to forever give you the tools of influence. I'm hoping this lecture is a catalyst for you so you now open your mind more to see when these techniques are being used on you and to study them yourself. Labeling is when you label someone and say your behavior is consistent to that label. I mean, it was used wonderfully in Star Wars, okay? When Darth Vader's battling Luke Skywalker, okay? And Luke's losing. And what does Luke say to Darth Vader? What does he say to him? He says, I know you still have good in you. I can feel it. And that was enough to turn Darth Vader over to the good side. We all can use this, and we can use it with our patients. So labeling is consistent. Now, how can we use that with patient care? How can we use it with, to be more effective at our job? I mean, you can label someone as an excellent parent, or you can label someone as being incredibly health conscious, or label them as an outstanding diabetic, or label them as a really good doctor. Okay, how can we use those, like with diabetics? I often give the spiel of acute modernization, and I say that to me, diabetics used to be warriors. In caveman time, if you were diabetic, it means your sugars ran high, your cholesterol ran high, and you could go on hunting parties. And people, if you weren't a diabetic, you couldn't keep up. I mean, if you were a diabetic, it was a gift. But we had a problem today with acute modernization. We got too good at keeping people alive longer and feeding them three times a day or four or five times a day. So I give them a label that diabetics are warriors. Hundreds of thousands of years ago, you were the warrior clan and be one today. But you're not fighting T-Rexes, you're fighting your sugar. You are a warrior. You're a warrior. And use those skills to battle your diabetes. How about with parents? Label a parent as an excellent parent. You know, the parent that comes in taking care of their kid, you kind of feel the draw for antibiotics. Say, hey, you're an excellent parent. Boy, I can see how involved and invested you are. I really am impressed with that, okay? I say to them, you've been doing everything right here. Tylenol, Motrin, fluids. Label that, yeah, you're a great mom. You're a very good mom. Validate their concerns, but also say now, anybody who's an excellent parent or good mom wouldn't want me to use antibiotics for something that's viral. And I know you're a good mom. You wouldn't want that. And what happens is they put the label on. Yeah, I am a good parent. Yeah, I am a good mom. And all of a sudden, when you discourage the antibiotic use, they see that as being consistent to their label. It's very effective. With physicians, you can label a physician as a good doctor. Patient says something positive about their doctor. Beautiful. Pass that along. Because when you get a doc on the phone and the patient said something positive about that doc, not only is it the law of reciprocity, because the law of reciprocity pays off here. Hey, Doc So-and-so, I got one of your patients here. Do you know Mrs. Smith? Hey, she speaks really highly of you. He gets the label of a good doctor, okay? Oh, I am a good doctor. And guess what? Good doctors wouldn't give me a hard time about admitting this patient, or good doctors wouldn't give me a hard time about seeing this patient tomorrow. So consistency works well with labeling. And if a patient mentions something positive about their doc, pay it forward, baby. Pay it forward, because it comes back on you. And let that be one of the first things out of your mouth, because squirrel, they're going to be triggered. Oh, yeah, I am a good doc. Right. I am a good doc. Good docs wouldn't give PAs in the emergency room a hard time. Very effective tool to use. Telemarketers are great at this, okay? They'll get a response that's consistent with a friendly demeanor, and they're trained to do this. So when a telemarketer calls, you get this weird 800 number. You know it's a telemarketer. They're going to call and say, hey, how you doing today? Pause. And then when you say, hey, I'm fine, then they go into their spiel, because what they just did was saying, by asking that question and you responding, they just got you consistent with the sensation of, hey, we're friends. You and I are friends, right? So you're not going to hang up on me. You're not going to brush me off on the phone, because I just asked you how you are and you responded. Now we're friends, and you are going to be drawn to stay consistent to that friendly behavior. They use it very well. So trust me, when a telemarketer calls you and they ask you how you're doing, maybe they care, I guess, or maybe they want to get you consistent with a friendly demeanor because they're more likely to convert donations. When it comes to consistency, also, small requests go a very long way, okay? Oftentimes, He'll make a request to a patient, oh, you got to lose 20 pounds. They see that as an obstacle that they can't overcome. They can't fathom it, so they immediately shut the door on it. We'll talk to you a little bit more about that by the end of the lecture. Small requests go a long way. Okay, this was proven in a study where they went to ask for donations from some charity. One way was to say, hey, can you give a donation to our charity? Another way would say, can you give a donation and every penny counts? So what they were doing was saying, if you make even a penny would be helpful here. They found donations went way up, but then the question is, well, would people not give as much? Well, when people gave an open monetary request, out of 100 people, they made $44. When they said, hey, can you give a donation, any penny, even a penny will help, the donations went up to $72. Again, all of these techniques of influence change about 50%. So, wait. If it's called the foot in the door technique. You get someone to say yes to something small, they'll say yes to something big. Automotive companies are doing this classically now. They'll try to get you into a survey by saying, hey, can I just ask you three questions? So they answer three questions, and they say, okay, thank you for answering three questions. You were so helpful. Do you mind that I send you a more detailed survey to help us out? What they did was they asked a small request. They got you to say yes. Now you're consistent to being a helpful person, and they're going to try to milk it. Okay, but we can use this to better affect our patients. So small requests go a very long way. And the key here is listen. The key here is the pause. You got to pause and get them to verbally say yes. Someone who's smoking a pack per day, don't say cut smoking down. I mean, you can say that, but that's not as effective as the foot in the door technique to say, hey, do you think you can cut down one cigarette a day? Just one. Just one cigarette a day. If you're going through a pack a day, can you go through a pack of cigarettes minus one? Just one cigarette a day you don't smoke. Are you able to do just that? Or can you walk 6 minutes per day twice a week? Just 6 minutes a day. Can you do that? And then you pause. You pause. Let them say, yes, I think you can do it. And what makes you think you can do that? You sure you can do that? Get them to say a couple times, yeah, I can do this. That's good. Now they're made a verbal commitment and they're going to be more likely to do what you ask of them. Eat one salad per week. Can you eat one salad per week? Just one. I don't care if it's on Mondays or Fridays, but it just has to be a medium-sized salad. Can you do that for me? Replace one meal a week with a salad. Or can you check your blood sugar at least once a week? Okay, once again, small requests go a long way. And it's a foot in the door. It's a way to get them to say yes. It's a way to engage with them and to influence them at a higher level. So remember, the key is to get the patient to verbally agree to this, okay? And then if you really want to anchor it in, once they say yes, that's great. Sir, I'm really proud of you. I'm going to put this on your chart and let the other providers who see you after me know your commitment to this small change. I really think that's great. And man, what's one of the worst words you can be called? Okay, what's one of the worst things that someone can say to you that would really get you to your core? Okay, think about that right now. What's one of the worst insults someone can say to you? And I believe one of the worst things is to be called a hypocrite. Okay, to be called a hypocrite. That's the power of consistency. We strive to stay consistent to what we believe we are. We strive to stay consistent to the image that we're portraying that others see us and how we see ourselves. The cavemen needed this. They needed to stay consistent to their roles within the cave. You want to cut down on no-show appointments. Now, what happens often is the secretary administrative assistant will write down the appointment and give it to the patient. The patient passively takes the card, doesn't actively commit to it. You want to cut down your no-shows by about 50%. Get the patient to write down their own appointment. Let them write it down and say, if you can't make it, will you promise to call us? Because there's a lot of people that want to get in. Then you pause. Let them make a verbal commitment to you. They want to stay consistent. They don't want to be a hypocrite. Nobody wants to be a hypocrite. That's one of the worst things we can be called. It's visceral. No, I don't want to be called a hypocrite. You want to stay consistent. What about real stubborn patients? What about your real stubborn patients? Use the Trojan horse technique, where you slip in the new ideas based on their old beliefs, okay? Their old beliefs may be something like as ridiculous as, well, I don't want to wear a seatbelt in a car. What do you mean you don't wear a seatbelt? Well, I could go in the water and I would drown. I had a friend of mine who was wearing a seatbelt and he crashed into the water and he drowned. Well, I don't wear seatbelts. Well, I mean, what you want to do is say, okay, wow, I can see that you're a survivalist. You're a survivalist, and that's on your mind. I think that's powerfully important. And based on the information that you had at the time, that was the right way to think. But now with the airbags and how cars are built, as a survivalist that I know you are, and with the beliefs that you have, also with these seven patients, I mean, you want to frame in a way that's not a mistake. But you want to say those beliefs that you had, that survivalist, it's consistent today with wearing your seatbelt. That's the person that you are. I know you want to survive. In the old days, it was kind of different information. Now we have better cars, better information. So I know you're a survivalist, and a survivalist today would wear their seatbelt, and I know that's part of who you are. So once again, stubborn patients, you can try Trojan horsing in the idea saying, hey, this is consistent with your old beliefs, but always remember to frame your questions and frame what you say to never say that what you were thinking was wrong. Hey, how you were thinking in the past, it was right at the time. Now things have changed slightly. Your thinking wasn't wrong, but with the facts you had at the time, anybody would have made that choice. But now the facts are a little bit different. Also note, ladies and gentlemen, we can label ourselves. We can label ourselves. How can we label ourselves as someone who's committed to fitness or committed to being an extraordinary provider? Okay, to make this effective, we need to take this label, whatever it is, and drive it into our subconscious. And how do we do this? How can we label ourselves to embrace the gift of consistency? Well, first off, use empowering language. How we talk to ourselves is powerfully important, okay? You say, oh, I'm a fat slob. And you really believe that as your label? Fat slobs don't work out. Fat slobs don't eat right. Fat slobs are undisciplined. But if you say, I'm carrying around 10 extra pounds, different language, different response to consistency. Pen to paper, when you write down things, journal, keep goals written down, that drives things into subconscious. And incantations are another option that I have used and employ, and they've been very helpful to me professionally as well as personally. Our class, reciprocity, consistency, L is likability. Likability, you gotta be well-liked. Okay, first and foremost, as a medical provider, you gotta have clinical credibility. You gotta know your stuff. You need to be very thought out, have perfect soap notes. You have to ask appropriate and thoughtful questions, especially if you're new somewhere, and you do not wanna get the perception of being lazy. Very important. So first and foremost in the medical field, you better kind of know your stuff. You better know your stuff and really be someone who works hard. You need to get that initial credibility when it comes to likability in medicine. Now in the book Influenced by Robert Cialdini, powerful book. I highly recommend it. It was kind of the textbook for all of the other books I read about influence in this program. They said there's five components of likability that's studied. This isn't my opinion, even though it makes sense. There's five components, and the mnemonic I use is CASTA, like you're casting a net, CASTA, C-A-S-T-A, CASTA. C is compliments. Compliments work. When you compliment people, they like you better. And very interestingly, flattery works. Okay, if you flatter them, they like you more. Okay, it's not uncommon to have, a mom bring in her daughter with some malady, and if I say, oh, it's clear that you brought your sister in today, speaking to the patient, right? The mom's like, oh, no, I'm the mom, right? She knows I know she's the mom, but it makes her feel good, and she likes me more about that. So compliments work. And I'm not saying embrace and manipulation. I'm saying if you keep a sensitive pair of glasses on about what you like in other people and mention that to them, I like those shoes. Hey, I like what you did to your hair. I really like how you take extraordinary care of the patients. As a nurse, you take that extra time, and I see that as really a great service you're providing to the patients. People love that. I love that, okay? This went on in a study at restaurants with waiters and waitresses and getting tips. The study went on mints, leaving a breath mint, okay, or an after-dinner mint, and they found that when a waitress left one mint per person, their tips went up so much, okay? No big deal, 3% they said. When they left two mints, the tips went up into the 14% range, okay? But what they found was this, when the waitress left one mint, turned to walk away, but then went, ah, for you nice people, I'm gonna leave another mint, okay? She complimented them by saying it was nice. They were nice. It surprised them. Oh, she thinks I'm special. Tips went up to 33%. I mean, tips skyrocketed. Patients want compliments. They need compliments. It's a powerful tool of influence. Don't be manipulative about it. Just keep sensitive to things that you like about others and mention it to them. Okay? Casta. C is compliments. A is attractive. And the literature shows if someone's more physically attractive, then they influence others more. Okay? And then you ask the Pfizer drug reps. Okay? Take a look at the Pfizer drug reps that come in to see you. At least they used to come in to see me, okay? Very attractive people, typically. Why did they pick very attractive people to do Pfizer drug reps? Well, because it works, okay? That's a similarity. There's a technique called mirror and matching. Mirror and matching is where you actually kind of almost imitate the person sitting across from you to get more likability. We have a tendency to really like people who like the things we do, that do the same things we do. So this is where you wanna highlight incidental similarities, okay? Someone likes to draw. You say, hey, I like to draw too. Hey, high five. There's a book called By Way of Deception. It's by a Mossad secret agent from Israel who defected to Canada. And he wrote a book on the secrets of the Mossad. And what they would do is they would find an agent or a target, someone they wanted to get more information, accidentally bump into them, but the agent, the Mossad agent, would know all about them so they could highlight similarities. It was very effective. There's been studies done where two people are in a room filling out an application, and the one looks over and sees the birth date of the other one. Little time goes by, and they say, hey, my birthday is December 13th. My birthday is December 13th. You like each other better. You can't help it. So similarities work. CASTA, C-A-S-T is team. People like people who are on their same team. This is very powerful when it comes to medicine. I've used this many times. I get a patient who's getting a little frustrated or irate about whatever the problem is. The nursing staff, the delays, whatever. I come in and I can say, listen, I'm your advocate. I'm on your team here. I'm not looking out for anybody, but I'm helping you. So, and I'm sorry for the delay because I'm on your team here and I want to help you out. I'm sorry that you perceive someone else's behavior as rude, but I'm on your team and how can I help you now? Car dealers do that all the time. Oh, I mean, I think we can do better. Let me go in and talk to the man, the boss about this, but I got you, but I can make this work, okay? But saying I'm your advocate has gone a long way for me. How else is this helpful? A big tool is people who come in and feel they need x-rays or CAT scans for something that they really don't need to be imaged. Now, it's one thing to say radiation. Oh, that's a lot of radiation. That doesn't scare people anymore. But listen, this is a pearl. When you say, oh, you don't want that ionizing radiation freaks people out. It's ionizing? Oh, yes, it is ionizing. Okay, I don't want that. I mean, and I'll share with them, a normal chest x-ray is about 2.5 days of radiation, solar radiation, where an abdominal CAT scan is about 3.5 years. It's a massive amount of radiation, scary amount of radiation. And when I say it's ionizing, it seems to be, it steers people away. And quite frankly, I don't want compliance when I'm influencing. I don't want conflict. I want commitment. I want people to say, no, I don't want that test. And then I'll document that in my note. Discuss with patients refusing CAT scan at this time, but if pain or symptoms get worse, we'll repeat the CAT scan when they come back. It goes over very well. It's very legally defensible in your note. So, last one is A's associations. We call it the halo effect. In economics and business, they call it the halo effect. If you are associated with something that's positive, whatever you do is going to be perceived as positive. If you're associated with something that's negative, it's what you do is going to be associated with something that's negative. When there's a new provider, if I see three patients that they saw and did a really good job, I'm going to associate this person with doing a really good job. If the fourth patient they really dropped the ball on, I'm going to, oof. I have these other patients that were really good to build on, so this has got to be a fluke. But if you have someone who's messing up regularly, even if they do a really good job, I'll think it was an accident. Human nature will think it's an accident, okay? In the Marine Corps, we used to call it being blue. Oh, that guy's blue. It means they have a halo effect. It's not a halo effect. It's a devil effect. Whatever they do right now, everybody's looking at him saying, ah, that guy's not real locked in. That guy's not really, he's in trouble. So people had a tendency to stay away from the guy that was blue because you don't want to be known by association, okay? They say you're known by the friends that you keep. It's not totally wrong in medicine, okay? When it comes to being on the same team, being likable, okay? If you want to raise, and this is good literature and it's studied in many of the influence textbooks, if you go to your boss and tell them how good you are as an employee, You don't get as much money as if you talk about how much you can serve the boss's or the hospital's needs, okay? So actually being likable equates to more money than being competent. The next A is authority. How do you become an authority, especially as a mid-level provider? How do you present yourself as an authority? And that can be challenging depending on where you practice, okay? Some hospitals I've worked at, PAs were regarded incredibly high. I've worked at a hospital that I thought my ranking on the hierarchy was lower than the nurse's aides. I was treated that rough, okay? Patients, same thing. What's their perception of you? So how do you establish yourself as an authority to best influence others? Technique, it's called a talk-up technique. Talk-up technique. Now, this allows other people to speak on your abilities and accomplishments, okay? Sometimes it can be hard to help to embrace this within a system because, quite frankly, I would like it. It would be tremendously helpful if the secretary, the nursing staff, the triage nurse brought a patient back and said, oh, John Belinsky's on today. He's a PA. Oh, you're going to really like him. He's super smart and nice. So they say it to him before I even walk in the room. Oh, no, he's a PA. Oh, he's been around for a while. You're going to really like him. If they talk me up, they make my job so much easier. And there's four components of the talk-up technique. First off, it's true. You say things that are true. This was studied in the real estate literature. So someone would call and say, okay, listen, I want someone, I'm looking to buy a house. Oh, let me put you through to Phil. He's been doing this for 15 years. You're going to love him. Great guy. They put him through, and as soon as Phil gets on the phone, you're not starting at scratch. You're not saying, hey, I gotta learn all about this guy. You've already got information. Oh, he's been doing this for 15 years, and he's a nice guy. The secretary seemed to really like him. I guess I should like him. Second thing is, people are okay with being the biased information. Clearly, the secretary has a bias towards getting Phil the sale, getting Phil the deal, but people, our subconscious doesn't go with that. I mean, that's why, as a speaker, when I'm introduced, you know, if I talk about all my accomplishments, that makes me look like a turkey. But if someone else gives you my accomplishments, it's you don't look at it the same, okay? So I can't go in and really talk myself up to get people to like me, but if someone does it for me, it works. Advertisers have mastered that, okay? Now, it works. This really works, and it's effective. And lastly, it costs nothing to do. How do you embrace that? Okay, maybe you can't get your nursing staff to talk you up, but you can sure talk your doc up. And the law of reciprocity goes a long way. Now, to gain authority is PAs, and this was studied by physician assistants. How do you gain authority as a physician assistant? One is your attire. To a degree, you will be judged by your attire. Again, very well studied. It's been studied. What's better accepted by patients, a suit or scrubs? And they showed similarities. They were the same. So scrubs, you know, but if you wear scrub bottoms and a t-shirt, you're going to go below that threshold. So how you dress makes you an authority. Display your degrees. If you have your degrees out, you immediately get put in a position of authority. So if you're working in an office where that's appropriate, display your degrees. Play up your associations. Boy, I've been working with Dr. So-and-so for so long, or I've worked with different doctors. I'm associated with this hospital. So use those associations to help establish yourself as an authority. And be careful about your online reputation, okay? Have you Googled yourself and saw what your online reputation looks like? Because that can help you or hurt you as an authority, and I believe that's going to become more powerful in the years to come, okay? Now, to be more effective and to be more of an authority with your patients, not only is this legally effective, it helps with influence, but also with billing. There's a word that was used very common. It was in the song in The Wizard of Oz. Why were they going to see the Oz? Well, because of the wonderful things he does, okay? The word because is a big trigger of influence. I think it comes from being a child. We're told what to do. Why are you doing it? Because, okay? We want to know because. And good literature has shown that we can convince people to do something if we give them a reason. To give someone something to do without a reason, our visceral response to turn away from, even if the reason isn't very valid, it's important for you to lose weight because it's going to help your heart. It's important for you to stop smoking because it's going to allow you to live longer and healthier. So because is a powerful term from an influence perspective, from a medical legal perspective. If you put down because in your chart, you document your medical decision making. okay? And that's very legally protective. It takes your charts out of a realm of negligence into judgment. It shows people what you're thinking, and the billers can use that. It's helpful in billing. Scarcity. Scarcity. Remember, our class, reciprocity, consistency, likability, authority, S is scarcity. We want what we can't have, okay? That's economics. If you can't get a lot of berries, well, guess what? You're going to want berries more. You're going to fight for berries more, okay? Limited appointment times. If you say to a patient, hey, we'd like to get you in, but we don't have many slots, it makes them want the slots more, okay? Telemarketers did this because they used to say, hey, operators are standing by. And people would have the impression of just a bunch of people filing their nails, waiting for a phone to ring. But when they change it to, if the phone lines are busy, keep calling. All of a sudden, people are like, oh, people are calling. That gives you a tremendous amount of scarcity. Maybe I can't get through. So almost by inconveniencing people, they called more often. This can be used tremendously effective with your flu shots. People want what they can't have. If you say, hey, your flu shot's important, but last year we had a shortage and you might not be able to get, I think you need one. I think you are a perfect candidate for it. I hope we have enough. The way to ensure that you get one is make sure you get an early appointment, because I sure want you to get one this year and I hate for us to run out. It will drive them to positively influence them to best help them. The last S is social proof, okay? We look to a group of people to tell us what to do if we don't know what to do, okay? Tell your patients that the majority of people are supporting a positive behavior, not the opposite. I mean, testimonials do this often with advertisers. Here's the warning though, avoid social norms that are disempowering. If you say, ooh, more and more people are smoking, or more and more people are not controlling their diabetes, you're telling them social validation says people aren't taking care of their diabetes. It's a negative way to do it. You wanna tell the social norms that everybody are doing, that everybody's doing. You know, more and more people today are really controlling their blood sugars in the diabetics. And that's a great thing. There's really a trend being set. More diabetics are taking care of themselves than I've ever seen before. It's awesome. You want people to go, wow, that's great. I better start taking care of my sugars too. You want to share with them social norms that will help them help themselves. Now, when it comes to trying to make those suggestions, know that any fear-based message that we present needs a solution or we ignore it. This was studied in college students with tetanus shots. They gave people all these fear of tetanus. They gave a pamphlet out and said, oh, the tetanus caused this, this, and this, and this. Go get a tetanus shot. They didn't give a clear solution to avoid the fear. So what happens is principles of influence saying, well, if there's a fear, but I can't really control it, then I'm gonna ignore it, okay? But there was also a campaign that said, the fear of tetanus is this, this, and this, and this. Go to the clinic at 7 o'clock and get your tetanus shot. Well, people lined up. It doubled influence. So anytime you're giving a fear-based suggestion to your patients, it's important that you lose weight because of your health and your heart. Here's the card of a nutritionist. They're gonna meet with you for the first time for free, and they're gonna give you some instructions on how to best eat. And here's the name of a trainer. You call him. They're gonna provide you solutions to lose your weight, okay? Provide a clear and crisp solution. It'll best help your patients, okay? From a social proof perspective, a couple last points to end this lecture. From a social proof perspective, know that error-based learning is more effective than information-based learning. When I say that, I mean, this was studied in firefighters. Are you just gonna give lectures or are you gonna teach from your mistakes? And that's something that I've embraced as an educator myself. Teach from your own mistakes, because people are really prone to learn from other mistakes. And I've found that some of my mistakes in the past that I've really carried a burden on has been some of my best teaching tools. So I can share with you what I've done in my clinical practice to not make the same mistakes, to be able to best help my patients by learning from my mistakes. So just know that when you're talking to your patients, first off, be very careful about pointing the finger. You need to lose some weight. You need to do this. First thing is just talk about your concerns. I'm concerned about your weight. You need to lose some weight. There can immediately go to conflict. If you say, I'm concerned about you. You're not going to do a commitment versus compliance. I'm just concerned about your weight. Okay? talk about yourselves. Hey, I struggle with my weight too, and this is what I did. So I would advise you to call this number and call this number. But for your heart, because your heart needs to be healthy, because you want to play with your grandkids, I think this is important. When it comes to social validation, pluralistic ignorance is how a big group of people can see something bad going on and everybody ignore it. Okay, pluralistic ignorance is where it's a social phenomenon that if people aren't reacting to something that's wrong, it's because, well, no one else is reacting, so it must not be too bad. I can overlook this. One of the ways to get around this, if something bad's going on, call someone's attention. It's very classic when I would be on EMS and helping at car accidents, or if I would stop at a car accident, or even like when I was directing traffic in the military. Okay, cars kind of drive around in this state of pluralistic ignorance, but if you point to somebody and say, I need you to direct traffic, you point someone out, they immediately snap to, it breaks them out of this pluralistic ignorance. Okay. One last note about social validation and influence technique. In your office, sticky notes work really, really well. If you're sending a note to somebody, or if you're giving someone a note or communicating in written, some kind of written communication, yellow handwritten sticky notes work tremendously effective to write someone's name down, write some pearls down. If you're sending someone a list of their labs, you take a yellow sticky note and say, if you have any questions, give me a call. Tom. They open that up. They see that personal note. It means a lot to them. It's no different than when a waitress writes thank you and puts their name down. It triggers a part of them, says, oh, this is personal. It's special. I like this guy, and I want to be compliant with what they're asking me to do. There's a number of great books. Once again, this lecture, I never intended to be a catch-all, to answer all of your questions and be a final solution to influence. Hopefully, this is just a catalyst where you go, these are important tools. These are tools that I can effectively use to help my patients to be not just compliant, but really be committed. So I recommend a couple of these books. Influence should be your number one textbook by a guy named Cialdini. So folks, my name's John Blinsky. My whole goal is to help you maximize your mind, okay? My whole goal is to help you maximize your mind. May I invite you to my website, seemeforlife.com. Again, that's seemeforlife.com.